Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the governance principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of governance that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 22nd of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right. Now we come to another related principle, the governance principle. Another important principle. Now, from now on, this one is a slight bit of inclusion with regard to all matter here, but now we're starting to get into issues that pertain to the human soul directly. And so we really want to speak with you about the human soul directly, really from now on, the next three principles. Because there's things we could say about other creation, of course, about all of these principles, because all of these principles do actually apply to other creation. But we feel that we really want to start focusing our attention now on the human soul and how it engages these principles and how the effects of will and desire upon the operation of these principles. So let's look at the governance principles. Governance principles will be discussed, as I've just said, in relation to self-aware beings with free will. So other beings are still controlled by governance principles, but the control is instinctual. And when I say instinctual, obviously with the smaller the particle, it doesn't have even instinct. It's more to do with chemical bonds and which I'm still referring to as instinctual. Does that make sense? Even though from a scientific perspective, that's not a part of instinct. The human soul, not the body or the spirit body, is a self-aware being with the ability to express free will depending on development. It's the not the body or the spirit body I'd like to focus your attention on. Most of you are still physical body centric, and this causes you to think that you can fix things in the physical body and they'll get fixed. And they won't, because the soul is the controller of the physical and spiritual bodies. So you have to fix things in the soul in order for things in the physical body or the spiritual body to be fixed. And it's very important that you see that. And then secondly, that our ability to express free will, the gift of free will depend greatly on our development of the soul. The lower developed soul, the more difficult it is to actually express free will. And therefore you are constrained by more laws, because you're not engaging the higher laws, which supersede or have hierarchy over, is probably the better term, isn't it? Which the higher laws have hierarchy over the lower laws. And if you do not engage the laws that have hierarchy over the other laws, then the other laws will apply to you. And that applies for all of the laws. So for many people on earth, all we're really doing is engaging the laws that govern the physical for the majority of us. And as a result, all of the other things, in other words, we've given away our hierarchy, really, haven't we? And as a result, all of these other things really dominate us. That's what it feels like, right? And that's because of our development. But let's look at the terms of development and so forth. Energy, we're still looking at the same definition for energy here, right? And it goes the information, energy, emotion, thought, communication, interrelationship or interplay between creation. Within or between, by the way. Development increases in quality and capacity as the human soul lives in more harmony with God's principles and decreases as the human soul lives in less harmony with God's principles. Now, you can see why that is the case, can't you? The more of the principles you engage, the more development you have. Does that make sense? As far as God's concerned, you've learnt more about love, therefore you have higher development. Power of governance is the energy able to be expressed by the human soul, which varies in quality and capacity in direct relationship to development. So power of governance is exercised by the human soul, but each of us have a different power of governance because each of us have different development. If we all had the same development, then we would all have the same power of governance. Because remember, the permanence principle is that God treats everything equally with regard to the soul. We're all treated equally. We all have the potential of the same power of governance. But the reality is, because of development, we've influenced our own power of governance. We've changed our power of governance. Does everyone get that? Okay. So, what does the principle look like? So firstly, governance principles ensure that everything is under God's authority. So God being the infinite, of course, being the fact that everything else is inside of God, of course it makes sense that everything is under God's authority. However, there are creations that are inside of God that are under human authority because of the gift of free will, which we'll talk about in 2 days' time, 3 days' time. God's laws control and govern all of creation. So there's not a single creation that can't get out of God's laws. All of God's laws have some effect on all creation. God's laws allow human souls to share governance. And when we say share governance, we're saying here to share governance with God. And also to share governance with each other. Does that make sense? So we've got to see how that works, right? And each human soul automatically governs, but the power of governance is determined by development. So it's not a choice to govern. In fact, the only way you can actually really exercise the choice to govern is by development. In other words, you have control over your development, but you do not have control over whether you automatically govern or not. Now, a lot of blank faces from that one. Would you like me to explain? Okay. From God's perspective, you are the highest of God's creation. Right? As a result, you, because of the hierarchy and scope principles, you automatically govern every other creation and even universes. So you've got a universe, which you govern, and under the universe is all the matter in the universe. Or you could even break it down further if you wanted to, couldn't you? You could go the living creatures. You could go other life is all governed by you. And you could say all matter is also really governed by you. And that's automatic. You can't stop it. Huh? So whether you believe it or not, and whether you know how to do it or not, you are doing it, is what I'm suggesting to you. Right now, you are doing it, whether you believe it or not, whether you know how to do it or not. However, your power of governance will depend upon your development. So, if this soul has hardly any development in love, in other words, they're living out of harmony with all of God's principles or the majority of God's principles, how much will it be able to control the universe? Next to nothing, right? How much will it be able to control other living creatures? Hardly at all, right? How much will it control other life? Hardly at all. Because it's got no power to do so. Power is depending on development. And this is why it takes collective power to do a lot of things on Earth. Not individual power, because we haven't got enough power, just one person hasn't got enough power to control, So we need to band it. We band, you know, our power is banding together. Naturally, as a part of the effect of each soul, it's banding together, and that forms the governance over our environment. 7 billion people banding together is a fair bit of governance, plus the nearly 20 billion of people who are actually earthbound, because remember, we've got to include them in the mix as well. So from God's perspective, we've got 25 or more billion people on Earth, 7 billion of which can be seen, which are all exercising power of governance over the Earth. That makes sense? But you take one of those people out, by themselves, they can hardly have any effect whatsoever over the Earth, by themselves. But you band those people together, and of course, that's going to have quite a large impact over the Earth, isn't it? But since the soul is automatically governing, as we've said here, then the only thing we can really vary is our power of governance, which is under control of your desire, your will. That's the only thing you can really vary, is how developed you are. Otherwise, you've got governance without development, so there's very little power. Okay, still got a lot of blank faces there. Is that because nobody's understanding, or is that because you've all understood? If we go to Monique and then down to Barbara.
By power of governance and control, do you mean over every living thing, what happens to that? What do you actually mean, sorry?
Yeah, I mean it on every single level. Even the combination of matter that occurs as a result of your governance, the decision-making processes that other creatures and other things do, which are all driven by the condition of your soul, that's all power of governance. This is all, you've got governance over all of that. Everything that's happening on the Earth at this point in time, not only including the people, but also including all other things underneath the people, which is all matter in the universe itself even, you've got power of governance over. Without you, a universe can't get created even. Right. So, give an example. The first human couple, when they were put on this planet, in their soul, when they joined to the two physical bodies that God created for them, they now were governing the planet, right? Now, in that condition, they were in what you would call now a six-sphere condition. Right? Now, those humans decided to walk away from God, and as a result of that, the power of their governance was such that they could no longer live in the six-sphere condition. So when they got to the fifth-sphere condition, a sphere in the spirit universe was created to house them, to house their spirit body. That was automatically created by them in their lower power of governance. That universe got created. And the same goes with the fourth, and the same goes with the third, and the same goes with the second, and the same goes with the first. And then there were degradations into the hells. And different people historically created those degradations into the hells. There's thousands of levels of degradation in the hells, and literally. And each new person who got to a worse condition created each layer, because they could no longer exist. The spirit body could no longer physically even exist in the layer above. So they needed another layer in order to exist. So there's an example of a person decreasing their development and still creating, but ever lower powers of governance in those spheres. So actually in the first sphere, there's creatures in the first sphere that the people in the first sphere have very little control over. They created the sphere, but they have very little control over the creatures, because their own power of governance over the very creatures they created by being in that sphere was limited. So that's it's an amazing thing. What it demonstrates is the worse your condition gets, the less power you're going to have. And God's trying to educate us that the worse our condition gets, the less power we're going to have. You get to the point where you don't even have power over your own body anymore. So your body gets a disease that you don't want, right? You say you don't want it, but actually your soul's created it because of its development and because it's no longer can govern the standard practices that would normally occur inside of your body to clear away disease. You know, your body's full of bugs and wogs and viruses and bacteria, you know that, right? It's got all these other systems going on inside of it. You've got complete governance over that, but dependent upon development. So the worse your development is, the more those things get out of control. Does that make sense? So this is how diseases get out of control in the human body. A cancer is an example of a disease that's gotten out of control in the body. The reality is, all of these diseases potentially can exist, but they can only exist inside of the human body when the soul's power of governance has been so greatly damaged that it can no longer control how those particular diseases are managed. Does that make sense? Same goes with viruses. Same goes with the animals and creatures around you. Like, why does a tiny little mosquito come and bite you? Because you've no longer got governance over it, because your development has decreased far enough that little creature can come along and bite you. Does that make sense? Right? Now, that's very much influenced by love of self, and there's not much love of self on the planet, right? And that's like that love of self governs so many creatures. So once you've got some love of self, now you've got the ability to govern these creatures. But if you've got no love of self, you can't govern them anymore. Your power of governance has been severely affected by living out of harmony with a lot of God's love principles. Does that make sense to you? Just that principle of love of self. Big principle that we ignore on the planet that causes the degradation of so many things, including our ability to control just tiny little things like mosquitoes. Now, the way we then revert to controlling them is, bang, she's gone, all right? And that's how we control them. But it's a force of effort now, whereas before, if the soul was in the right condition, it'd just be automatic. They just wouldn't bite you. Does that make sense to you? Right? So you know, some people, of course, don't get bitten. Well, they must have a bit higher condition of love. So what I notice, if I'm sitting with a group of people around me who have a lower self-love than I do, and by the way, I don't have a well-developed sense of self-love yet, but just if people around me have a lower sense of it, I don't get bitten, they do. But if I sit with somebody who's got a higher condition of self-love than I have, then I get bitten and they don't. Because that's where the insect is going to go. Does that make sense? Yeah. And that's all because of power of governance. The power of governance is dependent upon development. That make sense to you?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's look at some of the questions you've asked about it. And we'll see how we go with them. So can we start with Hunter? And Joanne, where's Joanne? You're there next to Hunter, so we go straight from Hunter to Joanne. And Anna, where are you? Anna, you're next there as well. We'll go next to you. And Joyce, where are you? Over there, so that's where we'll have the mic and when we get to Joyce. So you're all in a row. Okay, so let's start with Hunter.
How do human souls share governance?
Remember I said in the description that God shares governance with us and he allows us to share governance with each other. Now what that means is that if you get one soul, it's got a certain effect on the universe, a certain effect on the living creatures, a certain effect on other life, and a certain effect on matter. But if you add into the mix another soul, obviously that's got a different amount of effect on each of these things, right? different effect on the universe, different effect on the living creatures, different effect on other life, different effect on matter, based on its development. So this one's development might be, you know, better, and this one's development might be a bit worse, let's say. But the issue now is that these two are together on the earth, and so therefore there's a blending or an intermixing of their conditions, which is controlled by law. So now the sum total of their condition, or you could say the average of their condition, right? It's not really the sum total, it's the average of their condition, and the amplitude of the control is the total of their condition. So the type of control is dependent upon the average of their condition, and the amount of control is dependent upon the amplitude of their condition, how much they exercise that condition, in other words. Now, these two things are now blended. So can you see that automatically changes, since they're living in the same locale, that automatically changes the effects on everything that's underneath. So can you see they are really sharing governance? Without them knowing, they're sharing governance. So you have a partner, you buy a house, both of you, the interblending of that condition is going to determine what happens to this house, what's going to attack the house, and all these other things that go on in the house is all going to be determined by the interblending of the condition. In that way, you're sharing governance. But it's even more than that, because God, who has authority over the entire system, allows you to have this effect. So in a lot of ways, God is saying, I'm sharing governance with you. I am giving you, through the gift of free will, the ability to have governance. And then in that process, I know, God's saying to you, I know that you may affect these other things of mine. In fact, God's created a system via which you do affect the other things of his. And he's allowed that to happen for your education. Right? So in that way, God is sharing his governance with you. Right? Now, it has to be a pretty confident being that does that, doesn't it? Can you see that? So God's pretty confident about his laws. He knows that sooner or later you're going to be sorted out with this. Otherwise, he wouldn't do it, would he? He'd say, no, stuff that. I'm not sharing governance with this group of people. he'd do something different. So he's pretty confident about, firstly, how he's created you, and he's pretty confident about how he's created the world around you, the universe around you, and he's very confident, of course, in his laws that have established the boundaries by which you can operate. But he does do it. He does share governance with you. Yeah, it's just interesting, isn't it, how that's the case. Yeah. Let's go to Joanne.
I have two questions, so which one?
Number one, thanks, Joanne.
If we are unaware or not sensitive to our current soul condition, then does the law allow us to govern without awareness, or is there another law that corrects for this?
Well, yes, the law does allow us to govern. This principle does allow us to govern without awareness. In fact, we are all governing without awareness at any level. We're all governing something without awareness. Even in the union state, we're still governing some things without awareness because we don't know about them yet, right? So we're unaware. Right. But in the union state, it's a little different because you're in harmony with all of God's laws and principles by being at one with God. So it doesn't matter. Whereas anything state below the seventh dimension, it does matter because you're now governing without awareness and also at the same time not being in harmony with God's love or principles. But yes, we are in an unaware condition. We govern like this. This is happening. This process is happening. We're governing in this unaware condition. Now, the thing that corrects for it, though, is that these creatures reflect our governance. So they reflect back to us how effective we are in our governance. Does that make sense? As I've said earlier, mosquito comes and bite me. I'm not very effective with my governance. I can't even control a tiny little insect and tell it what to do. That's how limited in my power of governance I am with that particular thing. Does that make sense to you? So that tells me that I've still got work to do with whatever controls that biting me, which is all about self-love, self-worth, and those kind of issues, right? So I've got work to do there. It tells me that straight away. When I sit together with a group of people and I don't get bitten, that tells me they have a bit more work that they need to do on it than I do. Does that make sense? But I still got work to do because when I'm by myself, I get bitten. So that tells me I've got work to do. You see, it's the creation reflects back to you your power of governance. Now, your power of governance, as we said here, remember, wrong way. The power of governance is the dependent upon development. So what is it reflecting back at me? My development. Because that's the only variable in my power of governance, is my development. It's reflecting back at me that my development needs to improve. So this is a great thing. Because what it does is assist me to see, I've still got work to do. That makes sense? Now I can start to look at what that work may be. That's the beauty of this system. So, yes to your first question, do we govern in an unaware state? The answer is yes. Is there another law that corrects for this? No, the same law corrects for it by giving us a reflection of our developed condition. The same principle does both. So that allows me to see how much power of governance I really have. Now, we often have the illusion we have a lot more power of governance than that because we force most things. It's like when the mosquito comes along, we kill it before it bites us. So that's us enforcing our power of governance without actually, like the real question needs to be asked is, why is it biting me? If it's such a tiny little creature, why is it bothering me so much? Is the real question we need to ask, isn't it? Why don't I have some kind of governance over it? There's got to be reason. And this is it's the governance principle that supplies the reasons to us, but most of the time, because we're unaware, and we're talking responsibility about awareness, because we're unaware, we neglect the principle. We neglect examining our development. Yep. So let's go to Anna. Thanks.
Yeah, I was just going back to the sharing of governance. Mm-hmm. So it's how would this manifest in a soulmate relationship with both individuals having well-developed wills? Is it like good health, no accidents, and how does the power granted manifest itself?
Right, so how does it balance out? So here we have, remember, by the way, that when we talk about the soul, we're talking about both halves. And unfortunately for the majority of us, we're in a state of a lack of awareness of those two halves, aren't we? So we're basically creating a separation, aren't we, in between the two halves when we're lacking awareness. You see that? Now, a separation of the two halves is an energetic separation between the two halves. So this means that no energy can flow between the two halves. So no energy can flow in that direction. That's how it's meant to flow. So in green is how it's meant to flow. And blue will be how it only flows because we imagine ourselves to be separate from our mate. So that can only flow like this way, can't it? Inside of the half. You follow me?
Yeah.
Okay. So first we've got a problem because we're already in an imaginary state where we believe that we're not in union with our other half. And there's a whole heap of emotional reasons for that lack of union, right? And those emotional reasons include your intergender emotional injuries, which we've been talking about with you this week, have they not? So all those intergender emotional injuries, you know, the anger you have with the other half, that's when I say you have an anger with men and you go, but it's with my dad, or but it's with the guys I had before. No, it's not. It's with all guys, you know. And if a guy happens to be your other half, you're angry with him too, right? This is a block in the energy flow between the two sides. Now, obviously, if the whole soul has energy flowing around it, that's going to be far more power than if a half of the soul has a limited amount of energy flowing in it, isn't it?
Yep.
Didn't you see that? So let's say one half is completed with their energy flow. So let's say this half here is flowing real good internally, and would like to flow externally but can't because the other half's blocking, right? This half's going real well. Then this one's bodies will be pretty good, won't they? They'll be under control, no disease. They'll probably look pretty young. They won't be getting too old too rapidly. Does that make sense? They've got a lot of really powerful things going on there. But the other half, because the energy flow isn't completed, what's going to happen here? Well, this person might still be getting diseases, still get sick, still have problems with its relationships and so forth, because it's not flowing here properly. Right? There's no power of governance even over its bodies anymore. No power to keep it in harmony with love, because the soul itself is out of harmony with love. It's going to make sure that the bodies are out of harmony with love too. And so there's going to be a result of that. Does it make sense, Anna?
Yeah.
Yeah, ask away.
Yeah, so when they are linked, does it double or does it like quadruple or potential for power?
Well, it's sort of like a runaway train when they're linked. Because one supplies energy to the other, and that enhancement of energy gets supplied through their own enhancement of the same desire to the other and so forth and so forth. And it sort of becomes an immense amount of energy as a result. But you can see the opposite is true when they're not linked. So one tries to supply the energy, the other blocks the energy. So now the energy can be generated by the amount of power that the half of the soul has, which will be dependent upon its own development. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But the whole energy of the soul is going to be severely affected, obviously, and hence you can never reach a union condition in that state or obtain the power required to, in that condition, to govern. Does that make sense? Yep. So when it comes to soulmates, you can see there's this added complexity, and that is that the imaginary condition, when I say imaginary, it's not just that you imagine it, you actually are in it because of the emotional blockages you have. And those emotional blockages are not only the blockages you have with the other gender, but the blockages with regard to love of self, how much you engage addiction and all those other things all have an effect. But then the power of that half can be less than the power of this half. But if they were both living in the same house, there would still be a commingling or a combination, an averaging, if you like, of their condition to see what happens with the results. So let's say one half is completely blocked to generosity. The other half is completely open to generosity. The sum total will be that there'll be some openness and some closeness. In other words, together they might receive enough donations to live on. But if that one half went and lived separate to this half would not. So this is where many of you are in an imagined state. As well, you're actually relying on the development of the other person you're with to provide a lot of things that if you were by yourself, you wouldn't be able to provide. Which is interesting, isn't it, in itself? And this is where we can fool ourselves as regards our condition. Yeah. So it's an interesting question with regard to soulmates and what happiness and what happens there in regard to the relationship.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah. Pleasure. Joyce, where are you? Yes, you got the mic. Let's go for Joyce's question. Just let me rub off something here while you're giving your question to everybody.
As very dark people on Earth can have a lot of power over other people and creatures, is this power of governance? And if so, does mean that that power of governance can only be restricted or advanced according to soul development once we pass into the spirit world?
Yeah, so this is a good question, right? Because, and many of you have asked forms of this question. You've said, this power of governance thing is heap of crap, right? Really, that's how you feel. Because on Earth here, look at it. Look at the mess. There's people who are not in a nice condition, they're not loving, they're not kind, they're not in truth, and they've got the power. So where's this power of governance thing? Okay, the answer is quite simple. It's like this. Just trying to manage all my pens while I do the other thing. The answer is quite simple. So here's this little soul. I'll draw him small. He's the one who wants power. without having any power of governance. In other words, he's got no development, right? So he's a little tiny soul, no development from God's perspective. Therefore, by himself, he's got no power. But let's say he's willing to exercise rage and anger and another, a lot of other emotions like that. Let's say he's willing to do that and he desperately wants power. He's going to need, now, he's going to need lots of little souls who have just the same development to agree with him, isn't he not? And so forth and so forth and so forth and so forth. And every one of those souls have to agree to give him the power. Can you see that? They will have to agree to give him the power. Now, this is the issue we tried to raise at the start of the group, if you think about it. Many of the women that we've had to eject have wanted the power, and many of you are willing to give them the power. That's a problem, isn't it? Because the problem with giving them the power is you're giving away your own power of governance to another person, which increases their power, does it not? You're voluntarily giving it away, their power increases. And when I say voluntarily, many of you go, but it's not voluntary. I'm just scared of them, and that's why I do it. That's voluntary. You giving power to someone because you're afraid of them is a voluntary giving away of your power. It doesn't matter. You can call it something else if you want. But it's actually, from God's perspective, voluntary. You're doing it. You're giving them the thing. You see, a person who truly doesn't do that, would, no matter what happens to them, whether they die or not, they're not going to give their power. That's what they'd do. Right? They'd only give their power to a person or desire to give power to a person who had more love. That's all they'd choose to do, right? But this is a person who actually... The sad thing, this person is actually usually in a worse condition than these people. And the primary emotion dominating the fact that he gets power is the fear in this group of people. Can you see the damaging result of fear? Fear is a lot worse than you guys are turning it or making it out to be, because it actually causes people in dark conditions to gain power over others by the others who are in fear giving away their power. Now, why do we do it? Well, you know, usually this person has a couple of, let's call them gifts, shall we? I don't know if we could call them gifts, but I'll just do it in purple. I don't know if we could call them gifts because they're not gifts from God's perspective. But usually one of their gifts is anger, another is condescension. Is that how I spell it? Condescension. Ascension. Another gift they have is manipulation. Another gift, all of these seem to be pretty dark gifts, right? Can you say they're learned behaviors really rather than gifts? And can you see these things really add up to the manipulation of addictions? And this is where many of you still haven't seen the problem with your addictions. If you have addictions, you can be manipulated. People in power, people who want power without governance, without development, people who want power without development, always manipulate addictions to get it. Your fear is an addiction. Your desire for approval is an addiction. Your need for someone to make you feel safe is an addiction. These addictions can be manipulated to enable, to force you, what you think is force, but to encourage you to give away your power of governance. That's why they're manipulated. You follow me? Now, that is how a person on earth who is in a bad condition of governance, bad development, poor condition of development, but he finishes up getting governance over others. Now, from God's perspective, does he have governance over anything? No. He only has governance over the people who gave him the governance. He doesn't have governance over other creatures. He doesn't have much governance over the environment. It's the collective governance that's still really being exercised. Can you see that? It's the collective governance, and these are just manipulated by these things. Manipulation of addictions, which is really, again, the fear is involved in all of those things, right? Every politician on this planet at the moment who reaches a condition of being in power of a country is an expert at this. And they have teams of people to help them do it. They feed the media, they feed the organizations, and the media is experts at this. And in fact, in many cases, your own doctors are experts of this, and your own lawyers are experts of this, and your own people in your environment, including your own business owners, and all become experts at this because it's the only way a person who has no development can gain governance. It's the only way. By feeding the addictions and the fears of others. Can you see the problem with giving it away? Giving away, not resolving fear, not resolving your addictions. Can you see it? It's quite a huge problem, right? But this is why the earth is in such a poor condition. It's not because there's God, you know, God's done this thing of, oh, you know, how long is it? Like some of you ask this question. How long is it going to stay, this terrible condition? Why does God let it go on for so long? Who's letting it go on for so long? It's not God. God's got all of God's laws and principles all in place to stop it. Who's letting it go on this long? It's not God. It's us. And particularly it's the people who are living in fear and addictions. Particularly them. Because they give away their governance, and they give away, so, you know, somebody promises me some extra tax money. Oh, yeah, I'll do that. Someone says, oh, I don't like Mexicans. Somebody says, we're going to build a wall between us and Mexico. You're going to go, yes, let's go get him. Let's give him some power because I don't like him anyway. You see what I'm saying? He's feeding my addictions, my unloving behavior. That's what he's doing, right? Somebody at another place says, let's give him a tax cut. Why are they doing this? Just feeding addictions. I feel that since I get something extra in my pocket, I might vote for him again. Just feeding my addictions. Right? This is how people on earth get power. We can't blame God for it. You certainly can't blame God for it when you're the one giving them the power. Do you understand? You can't blame God for that. That's your problem. That's your fear, your addictions, your response to condescension, your response to manipulation, your idolization of people who are in dark condition. That's how they get their power. Right? That's an issue that we have. We need to resolve that. So I can't emphasize that enough. It's a great question, Joyce. It was the same question asked in the first group too. And we had a similar explanation. I just went a bit further with it this time. But can you see the problem? Yeah. The problem isn't that the issue of governance with in relation to development, which is the way God assigns power, but rather it's because we, who have a limited amount of power anyway, because our condition of development is poor, we just go and give what we even have right now away. And we do it because we want things done in harmony with our addictions and fears. And this person says he's going to do it, so we do it. Or her, by the way, says she's going to do it, so we do it. So for many women, it's like, give me freedom over my body. which for most women also means that I can have an abortion whenever I want, right? And who are we going to vote for if that's the addiction? Now, we've got some fears and addictions in that place, addiction to feel like we're in control of our life and afraid if a baby comes along, how much that will interfere with our life and so forth, fear that we won't have enough money. There's all sorts of fears there, but because somebody comes along and says, I'm going to give you power over your own body and I'm going to let you do this and do that, you know, there's no way men should take away this from you, and they get hooked into a number of other feelings that you have, and before you know it, you give away your power to them. And vote for them.
So this is really just the person is receiving power from other people, not from God. Is that
correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. And is he even receiving power from people? Isn't it collective? Mm. Isn't the collective condition determining who's given the power? Mm. He's not even really receiving it, is he? He can't really do what he says he's going to do unless he obtains this agreement from every other person. Mm. Unless he enters these codependent addictions with every single person, he's not going to succeed. So for example, how does a president in the United States get a second term? By feeding as many addictions as possible in the first term. That's how he does it. So your current president, or the one just voted in, if he feeds as many addictions of as many people as he possibly can in the first term, he's definitely going to get a second term. Mm. Unless the condition of the people changes. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And they say, no, I've had enough of this now. This is out of harmony with love, out of harmony with principles. Right? But the trouble is most people are not that developed, because all we're interested in is little old me. And I say little old me purposefully because this is little old me, right? You could be big, big powerful you, right, in comparison. But no, we don't want to deal with our addictions and deal with our fears, so we're going to stay little old me, feeling powerless all the time. And then when somebody comes along and says, I'll do for you what you can't do for yourself, you go, yippee, I'll give you whatever I've got left so that you can do what I can't do for me. And this is our big problem. We're trying, these people promise to do what we don't do for ourselves or can't do for ourselves because of our development. And because we don't understand the principle of development, we're not even understanding why we can't do it. And instead, we give away whatever we got left to other people who say they're going to do it. And the only way they can actually do it is by getting all of our agreement to do it, or at least 50% in a democracy of our agreement to do it. Right? And that applies to a dictator as much as it applies to a democracy. And this is why all forms of government on the planet are pretty much flawed. Yeah?
Thank you.
Do you want to just pass it forward to Alan?
What's the tipping point when people start to become at one with God on the earth, and how, you know, in terms also of sharing governance with the people who are little?
Well, the reality is that a person who becomes at one with God on earth is in a condition of love. Now, if everyone around them desires to give their power still to the person who's not in a condition of love, can you see that that person on earth will seemingly, from the people's perspective, have hardly any control or governance over the rest of the earth? Isn't that true? However, every other creation other than the human is going to respond to that person. So that one person has dominance over all the other creation except for the people. Because the people have free will and they have to determine where they're going to put their governance. Does that make sense? So that's the decision we need to actually make at some point, isn't it? Now, if we had things more operational in terms of God, we'd select the most loving people and then we'd give them governance while they exhibit the love. But if they don't exhibit the love anymore, you take away governance from them and give it to someone else who exhibits more love. The problem is, most of us are driven by these things And so even if a loving person does come along, or even 20 loving people or 100 loving people come along, who are in a much, they're going to have a large power over everything else, but they're not going to have power over the people.
Okay, thanks.
Right, because the people have to choose how their desire and will is exercised. Yep. Can I move on next to some of these questions, and I'll try to get around the ones that I haven't got yet. Okay. Nikki, can we go to you next? And who's this behind? Eloise, there, can I go to you after we're you, straight back. And on the other side, where's Kathy? Kathy's here, so if we can have one down with Kathy. So, Nikki.
Which question?
Nikki, question one, thank you.
Okay, so you can't answer it already, but...
I have.
On Earth, it's frequently seen that more power is given to those in a lower development of love by others, e.g. politicians. Does the governance principle in God's laws work to restrict that person's influence over time?
Well, yes. The answer, so this is more of a question about how do God's laws operate upon this person that all of you have given power to? Does that make sense? How does God's laws work? Well, it's quite obvious that God's laws are still working exactly the way God's laws have always worked, and that is that governance depends on development. That's how God's laws work. So from this person's, from God's perspective, this person has no power. Does that make sense? And when he arrives in the spirit world, he'll see he's got no power. He'll see that he's got no power of governance at all over his creations, because in the spirit world, some of you have asked questions about, it's more refined the way this forced, what you do here is now forced upon you there, right? So now this person will see he's got no power at all. But on earth, right, from God's perspective, he still has no power. He only has power because of what the people have allowed him to have. So people who don't act, people who live in fear, people who live in addictions, people who live in violence, people who do all of these things without just saying, no, I am not going along with this particular person, I'm not giving him my power. You don't have to be violent about it. Unfortunately, everyone on earth who doesn't agree is usually violent, so they're just as bad, right? You don't have to give them power. You just don't agree with the power, the way it's in exercise, and you don't agree with it and you don't go along with it. When you're in that state, what happens now? This person has no power anymore. What can he do? He's limited by the fact of his governance condition, isn't he? Yeah. Just like everybody else is after that. So from God's perspective, God's laws are already restricting him. And it's only the human's disagreement with God's laws that causes him to get the position he has.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But God's laws are already working to restrict the man or the woman in that position.
Cheers.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, if we go to Kathy first, and then we'll go back up to, who did I say it was? That's right, Eloise. I've just got to keep an eye on that page. Kathy's page. Yes. Fire away, Kathy. Okay.
Are there specific laws that determine the time frame for how long it takes creations out of harmony with God's principles to be destroyed? Why are they not destroyed faster? Why eventually does...
Faster than eventually, you said in my question.
Faster than eventually.
Yeah.
Does the human soul play a part in how long it takes?
Yes, well, let's examine this question. So what creations are you referring to, Catherine, in particular? What were in your mind when you wrote the question? Can you remember? Use the mic there. It doesn't matter if you can't remember, that's fine.
I think they were just, you know, things in the world and in our relationships and things that creates pain in society and those sorts of things.
So you're thinking more about our emotional creations as humans than your physical ones?
Yeah.
Let's have a look at our soul-based creations, shall we? We could classify them, could we not, in three primary areas, right? Let's classify, put them as columns here, right? Three primary columns. The first column we'll entitle physical. Now, in this column come things like, I made a painting. I made a house. I made
a Berlin Wall.
A Berlin Wall, yeah. Yeah. What else can I, physically? Just anything. I made a garden. I made a disease. And so forth, right? Our physical creations, yes? All right, what are emotional ones? Let's look at the next one, emotional. And we'll classify the last one as spiritual. And remember, spiritual is primarily, we're looking at issues of love here, right? Or you could say, let's do it a little differently to that. There's my razor. Oh, yeah. Let's make it a bit different though. Let's go metaphysical here. And let's go soul here, just for a moment. All right, so what are the metaphysical creations that we have? All right, any ideas? Just yell them out and I'll... I think, isn't that a soul creation, fear? So that's... spirit world house. Home, let's call it home. And this one here would be fear. People get out, yeah. Any other things you think about? Spirit body?
Desires?
That would be here. Facade, yeah, that's definitely here, isn't it? And so we could list them there and so forth. Now, we're just classifying, if you like, our creations as a single soul here, right? Now, your question said, are there laws that determine the frame frame for how long it takes creations out of harmony of God's principles to be destroyed? Yes, there are, right? Now, the law that controls these creations are all the laws that govern the soul's desire and its current, its desire. The laws that govern these creations are all the laws that are governed by will and desire. And all of the laws that control these creations are God's. Given the fact, as we'll learn in authority, and we need to talk more about this in authority, but because I'm introducing some ideas here that we will talk about more in authority discussion, basically the house is all made of God's materials, isn't it? So you know, there's laws of decomposition, and if the house is dead, then they're going to be destroyed. It's going to take maybe a few hundred years for the house to be destroyed. But nowadays, the way they're making houses, some of them might get destroyed in 25, right? Yeah. Now, the disease, though, that's something in the physical too, but what created that? Well, isn't it, something going on in the facade, which is really linked to a desire of the soul, isn't it? So can you see that some of the creations that are happening in the physical actually are soul-based creations? And God's made you the governor of your soul, and God won't interfere with that. So if you want to keep that, that'll stay for as long as you want to keep it. That might be a million years. That's how long that one's going to last. If you want to keep it a million years, that's how long it'll last.
If it's a physical disease and you die from it...
Yep. Still going to be in your spirit body?
You'll still be ill in your spirit body.
Yeah. Yeah, and you'll feel it more too.
Really?
Yep. Yeah, you'll feel it more too. So let's say you've got a disease that really causes a part of your body to hurt extremely in your physical body. After you pass, you'll be ultra sensitive to that hurt in your spirit body. So you'll even be more sensitive emotionally to the hurt that thing's created until you want to address its cause. That makes sense? But let's say it takes you 500 years to address its cause, then it's going to last 500 years. Right? Because God doesn't have control over the creations. He controls the laws that controls your soul. And part of those laws say your free will dictate what happens to the removal of that problem. Do you follow? So can you see, for some things, they can be destroyed very rapidly. You could tomorrow get outside, look at your house and say, it's no good, I'm going to bulldoze it. Gone. In one day. Physical creation, gone in one day. You could also deal with the emotion that causes cancer in one day. You could even destroy that in one day. Most people don't, of course, because it's a very strongly developed emotion usually inside of us, and so it takes us time, many years usually, to work through that. Now, can you see that from God's perspective, he's already trying to get rid of everything that's out of harmony with these principles? He's already trying to, but he's given you the gift of will. And your will has a great determining factor as to how long these things will destroy it. Now, your question was, are there laws that determine the time frame? Yes, there are. Mm. And the laws, you can see, primarily based around will and desire, actually. Yep. Right? So while God is trying to destroy, you know, something like a Berlin Wall, yep, the fact that it might be made out of rock, it's going to take a few thousand years to get destroyed God's way. But you made it, right? Mankind made it. He could get rid of it tomorrow by pulling it down. So how long is it going to last? As long as it takes men to realize and women to realize that they shouldn't have it.
So that would be an opposite example of that the human souls got to a critical mass where they went, we don't want that, and it came down in 3 days.
After that's that right, decade. Exactly. Yeah. Soon as there was enough yeah, people saying, I don't want this anymore,
yeah,
and a lot of times it only takes a spark of a few people coming up with the idea, and everybody goes, yeah, what are we doing? We're putting up with this wall right the way through the middle of my city. What the hell's going on with us?
What were we thinking?
We've been putting up with this wall for 50 years. How stupid are we? Let's pull it down.
Let's pull it down.
And they start pulling it down. And, of course, given the amount of publicity and other things going on at the moment, if a government came along and shot them all for doing it, you imagine the outcry.
Yeah.
Right? But they were brave enough to do it, even though they probably thought they were going to die doing it.
Yeah.
They were brave enough to do it, right? That's how it came down.
Yeah.
It came down, remember the previous diagram? It came down with a few of those people who were living in fear going, I'm not going to do it anymore.
Not doing it, pulling their energy out.
I'm pulling my energy out. Not only am I going to pull my energy out, I'm going to start actually dismantling the thing.
Yeah.
They decided.
Plugging into something else.
So now they have an energy in harmony with God's principles.
So it happens really quickly.
It's going to happen real quickly, yeah.
Yeah.
As soon as your energy is in harmony with God's principles and collectively a number of us get to that same condition, now something has the capacity to happen within days, not years, not thousands of years, days.
Yeah.
You see, and so, because God's laws want it down anyway. So he's going, all of God's angels can now start assisting. They can start influencing other people to have the same desire. There's all sorts of things now that kick in the gear that allow for that to occur now. See, that before they had to just sit back and wait because they can't force a person to do something against their will, right? They have to wait till somebody comes up with a concept and idea. They have to wait till that person is brave enough to actually engage that concept and idea, start to actually share it and to do something about it. Now the laws are engaged. Now so you imagine how many spirits were behind the wall coming down.
Mm.
All of these spirits now can help the wall come down. So they start getting into the minds of other people. This guy's gone off and he's pulling the wall down. Nobody's shooting him. What do you think? Would you think we should get involved? Yes, we get involved. So they get involved and then there's all these people. Now it's on telly. And now there's a mass communication about it coming down and that nobody's getting hurt doing it. And because there's a lot... obviously the first person who tried to do it was in a state of a lot of courage,
yep,
right? But the next people, less courage because they...
They followed,
but also less courage because they had... obviously more fear. They weren't the ones who did it first, right? So more fear, they were giving away their power more, but as soon as they saw someone taking back some power, they did too. And that's how it came down. Does that make sense? So that's how change is going to happen on the planet, by everybody taking back their power of governance and actually critically looking at how they actually give away their power of governance. And what are they going to do? Are they going to decide to do something good, or are they going to keep doing things out of fear and addiction? Right? We've got to decide, you see. That's how it happens. Good question though, huh?
Thank you.
Eloisa is next. Thanks.
Which question, Jesus?
Number one.
And does anything govern God?
What's the answer?
No, because
no.
God.
Okay. So you knew the answer to that question. Why did you ask it?
I was just wondering if there was anything bigger than God.
Well, we've already covered that. God's infinite.
Are there any other gods?
Well, if God's infinite, how can there be other gods?
True. Okay.
Yep.
Why did I ask that question? Yeah, okay.
So I'm asking you why you asked that question. I think you're getting influenced to ask these questions that are not logical and out of harmony with what you've already been taught. You follow me?
I follow
you. Second question?
How did God get to be such a good governor?
I got no idea. So let me answer that question.
Yep.
Why is that? Remember, Rebecca asked the question in the previous discussion on hierarchy.
Yes.
She said, she asked me about, you know, whether God's love has a mathematical formula or whatever, and what would that be, and how would we know, and all those kind of questions. And what was the answer I gave her about that? I said, any question where you're asking me something specific about God, other than it being one of God's emotions, is going to be very, very, very difficult to answer.
Yeah.
So I don't know how God got to be such a good governor. I'm assuming that God was always a good governor at this stage, given the fact that God's infinite. Does anything govern God? No, I know for a fact nothing does, because God's infinite.
Yep.
The infinity principle precludes it from actually happening.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Awesome.
You want to go to four? Question four?
Sure. Each human soul automatically governs, but the power to govern is determined by development, which is in the outline.
Yep.
Would you please give a spiritual, emotional and physical example of these?
There's your example.
Thank you very much.
Of that question, that's why I wanted to ask it.
Awesome.
You can see the examples of different types of governance we have and how certain things are under our control and certain things God's trying to influence.
Yeah.
But and in fact, all of God's laws are trying to bring everything back into harmony automatically at this stage. But he has given us the gift of will and the gift, therefore, to exercise our current condition and our future desires. So the reality is all of us in a poor current condition could have a future desire that says, I'm going to get rid of all borders around countries. So en masse, 7 billion people could say, we're not going to honour passports anymore.
Yeah.
You imagine if 7 billion people did that, how could a government control it?
Okay.
Impossible, isn't it?
Yeah.
They can shoot half of them, but there'd still be all the others left. Do you know what I mean? At the end of the day, so if everyone just had that and that was solidified, no matter what.
Yeah.
No matter what, whether I get killed or not, no matter whether my family gets shot or not, no matter how much I get threatened, no matter how much I get tortured, this is what I'm going to do. I'm just going to give up the concept of passports. Can you see what would happen?
There wouldn't be any.
There wouldn't be any.
There's that power thing again.
Yeah. Right? Now, the problem is, though, on the planet, is that most of us have a lot of unloving desires.
Yeah.
So it would be very unwise to exercise the unloving desires en masse, because that would cause anarchy on the planet.
But
do you see?
We doing that to some extent already?
Of course we are. That's why we've got the results we've got. You see, the Berlin Wall got created because of somebody's unloving desires, which we're all agreed with, is it not? Right? The disease gets created because we decided we were going to engage the facade and addictions that created that disease. We decided. So it gets created. Our problem is that individually and collectively, we are not changing our desires to become loving. That is what is the cause of these problems, right? So passports are a very good thing at the moment. Why?
Why?
Because if a lot of people exercise their unloving desire to go from country to country, there is a huge amount of destruction that could occur. Do you see? There's a huge amount of destruction. But if everyone did it for a loving reason, now there wouldn't be a huge amount of destruction if you went from country to country.
Yeah.
So can you see that some of the laws that have been created on this planet have actually been created to circumvent our unloving condition? So we definitely don't want to get rid of those until we've gotten rid of our unloving condition.
Yeah.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, so stop thinking that, you know, it's going to be simple to change some of these things. No, you've seen how hard it is to change your own condition. So let's focus on changing your own condition. And this is why I'm saying to you, before you start worrying about what the world's doing, just go along with a lot of the laws are actually good at the moment for different reasons. Go along with those laws, except when they disagree with God completely. Go along with those laws, but change the condition. When your condition changes, now you have the option to change the laws. At the moment, many of you want to change laws without changing your condition. Not such a good idea. Because these laws have been created to govern your condition because of your condition. You know, the speeding law would not be required if all of you drove safely. If all of you drove safely, you get into a build-up area, you'd naturally slow down to the speed that you think that you know is safe in that area where you have enough distance to stop. Inside of you, there is this ability to calculate. If it takes me 4 car lengths to stop at this speed, and a child comes running out 4 car lengths, is that going to be enough? Maybe I need to show it down to 3 car lengths, right? So I can stop in 3 car lengths. That means only you're travelling at what? Probably 5 to 10 kilometres an hour at the most when you're in that environment. But if you're on an autobahn where there's no... You could speed up, could you not? Naturally, where there's no restriction, there's no towns, there's no... You know, you only have to worry about what other drivers are doing and so forth. You can speed up then. So you wouldn't need limits placed on you then, if you were loving. The trouble is most of us are not loving, and so we do need limits. And unfortunately, the limits that God have imposed, we ignore. Our soul's damaging while we're doing it, of course, but we're not sensitive to that, so we ignore it. So we need some physical limits. We can't get rid of these physical limits while we're in such bad condition.
Yeah. Yep.
Let's fix our condition, then we'll be able to fix some of the limits, you see?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Thank you.
Make sense?
It does.
Yep. Okay. 15. Just keep track of my times. Oh, okay. I'm meant to finish now. There's a problem. There's still some good questions, but I'm going to have to finish. There was some that I wanted to really answer. But I might have to skip that, unfortunately. There are so many questions here, and it's... No, I think I'll have to stop because the next one is important. So responsibility principle is important, so we need to cover them. So I need to stop here. Sorry about that. There's still lots of questions I haven't answered that I wanted to answer, but we'll get on to those hopefully now, my and Mary's discussion of them when we go to our studio. And what we're going to do now is finish off the governance principles. So it's the end of our discussion on governance. And if we can come back about 12 past 3, and we'll get started on responsibility principles.